Welcome to Mindless Entertainment. My name is Jesse Milestone, and we are going to discuss, dissect, examine the Battle of Winterfell from the episode The Long Night, which was the most recent Game of Thrones episode from Sunday. So if you haven't watched it, you don't want spoilers, get out! Get out now! Get out while you still can! The dead are coming! Oh my god! Anyway, spoiler time. So if you don't want spoilers, go away. Don't blame me. I warned you. So I want to take this episode, this hour 30 plus long minute episode, and just make a call, an assessment on the whole thing. Was this whole hour and 30 minute episode, how does all of the over 90 minutes of episode in here, was it worth it for me? Was it a good episode? How did I feel about it? I was freaking disappointed, guys. I was disappointed. Now, before you all cry and get your panties in a wad, there are things I really, really liked about it. There are things I really like. So let's talk about that. So you feel coddled and secure and good about my opinions before I rip you all to shreds. Sorry, that's I'm not actually gonna do that, maybe. I'm gonna be pretty brutal at some point, though, so stay tuned. There are things I love about this episode. Chiefly, Arya killing the Night King. I freaking love it. Because she's the character I've always identified with the most. She's the one I just felt the closest to, the one that I feel like I would be if I was in this story. So I love her getting that killing blow. I love the way she does it. I love her fearlessness. I love her ferocity. The one thing I don't love necessarily in this story is I'm not sure. It felt like a little bit much, like they drug it out, this whole like, oh, she's the toughest, she's killing everyone, oh my god, she's overwhelmed. I feel like she kind of went a little too much into fear, and a little too much running away, and then I get like the whole, you know, suspense of, you know, you have a purpose and whatnot, we're not going to tell you what that is, oh, you're going to shut some blue eyes, oh, what does that mean, oh, and then bam, she kills him. That's cool, but then I feel like also that we're missing some stuff in between. There's just a little bit, some of the way we get there, like, oh, Beric's whole purpose was, I feel like Beric Dondarrion's death could have had a slightly, because I feel like, I mean, maybe I'm just not remembering it intensely. He shows up and he does help her get out of all of that, but it's not like there's a moment where he gives his life to make sure she lives, which I feel like, given the whole, he's been kept alive and brought back to life so many times for such a purpose, like, maybe that should add a little more weight, but I guess it kind of makes sense. I mean, maybe, it's hard, Game of Thrones is difficult to dissect for me in some ways, because there are things I like about it so much as a show and as a book, in that, more as a book than the show, in that it breaks those expectations, that it doesn't build in these big ways where everything lines perfectly and works exactly along your expectations. So in that regards, I like it. It just sort of took me a second to be like, oh, okay, you know, to sort of put the pieces together, I guess. But I guess, I mean, I don't know if I like it or not yet. That's sort of a thing. It pissed me off that the Hound had another one of his, like, I'm just gonna freeze up and freak out moments. Like, come on, you've been doing this for the past, like, 2 or 3 seasons now? It's old, we're over, we get it, you freak out at the end. Though it was a nice moment, although not unexpected, when he sees Arya and he goes, I'm gonna go defend her, because obviously he's gained a, you know, a deep connection to this character. So that's nice. But the fact that she does it, the fact that she's the one that kills him, is so perfect. And this is where there's a couple things in this show, the two things I like the best. They're steeped in a lot of a symbolism like, overarching the way that this show, it has a lot of layers. I mean, the way the Game of Thrones as a story has a lot of layers, so I'm not necessarily crediting the show for it, but definitely the books, has a lot of layers in that it gives you, you have metaphors, you have symbols, you have themes, you have motifs, and then you have the little bit bits and the characters and their interactions and their personalities, and this is the very grand overarching, you know, a part of that, where you have, this is the quintessential good-evil struggle, the life-death struggle, as Bran even puts it the episode before, how he's carrying all the memories of the history of Westeros. He is the representation of life in Westeros. And then on the flip side, of course, the Night King is the embodiment of death. And then so you have Arya's little moment of, you know, death has many faces. I look forward to seeing this one, which is when you go back, is a key moment of foreshadowing there. And that's really perfect in that sense. Okay, so you're using life to lure up death and all that beautiful stuff. But you have with what Arya is. An agent of death, she's a, and an enemy of it in that sense, because she can, because of all her, you know, magical faciness things, she has all these special abilities that make her that have her walk in step with death in certain ways while being able to execute it. So the fact that she, the one who arguably understands death better than any other character, is the one who kills death is perfect. And so that sort of symbolistic meeting, I don't know what this is, it's two llamas without ears making out really aggressively. But anyway, that marriage of those two cons, of that concept of you know, the one who knows death the most intimately is the one who does death, and it makes sense in that respect. I love it. I know that apparently there are some people out there being like, she's a Mary Sue, and I'm like, come on. she spends episodes, seasons training to become this person, to become this BA badass assassin. Come on, give it a rest, guys. That's not what a Mary Sue is. A Mary Sue is not just any woman who does something powerful, okay? That's stupid. No, Arya's fantastic. Arya's a wonderful woman. Most of the people, that's very, very few people that I've heard saying that at all. In fact, probably people just, you know, paid to stir up trouble on the internet. So that aside, no, brilliant, brilliant moment for Arya. And then it's also on that secondary level, on that next level down, you have, it's the Stark siblings protecting each other, right? So you have your grand, the agent of death is killing death itself to protect life, but in the more human level, these are the Stark siblings defending each other, which is what makes Theon death so great in that moment. Is a lot of this season, the end of last season, this season so far, is him reconciling that identity. I mean, his whole journey since leaving Winterfell the first time is the balance between, is he a Stark or is he a Greyjoy, and fighting to prove that he is in fact a Greyjoy, while in this moment coming to terms with the fact that he is a Stark at heart. And his heart and soul says he's a Stark, so he dies defending his brother, essentially, in the same place where he's defended the same brother before. So it's again, it's nice framing, a nice little wrap up, a nice little neat little bow on the story. There's no point in Theon surviving anyway, since he can't make babies. So who cares about his lineage? There is no lineage, but I think it was a beautiful way for him to die. And you know, if you want to say, oh, it didn't mean anything, well, it bought just a little bit of time. It bought maybe just the right amount of time for Arya to get there and do what she needed to do. So that was good. I was yay with that. And the other thing I love about this show, well, first we're gonna think that was dumb. You have a Night King that you know can raise the dead, so you hide everybody next to a bunch of dead people. Didn't think that one through, did you now? But anyway, that aside, as I smash my camera in delight and excitement, Sansa and Tyrion, man, I really hope that we actually get a romantic connection. We've seen them grow to mutual respect recently, but this actual, you know, connection, I'd love to see that them lean into that more. It's such a great arc for Sansa to, you know, go from the completely shallow, completely self-absorbed, all she wants is a sexy man, it doesn't matter if he's a murderous psychopath, thinking, of course, when she got married to Tyrion the first time, this was the absolute worst thing that ever could have happened to her, because L, and then to go through what she went through with Ramsay Bolton, and to come around and find really that he was the best of them. It was such a great moment, and the kind of woman that is good. I mean, especially because she's blossomed not only as this, you know, powerful character, but as this potentially very, very intelligent character who could be a great match in that way for Tyrion. So I hope that they foster that more. I hope that there is a more of a love connection. I really like it. It just makes me happy. And it's also a logical, you know, union again, House Lannister, House Stark. We got to think into the future now and have those unions. So that's the future. We'll talk about the future in just a second. And the things I didn't like about this show is just so much wasted time! Everyone, save your hour and 30 whatever minute episode for you to a fucking episode where you can give me real information! I am so sick of getting bored of things just repetition, stop looking each other in the eyes. And in this one, it wasn't so much that. It was a lot of like, I mean, just stupid things. Like, why did you put them in the crypt, you know? Oh, you had the dragons ready to go to light up these armies. Why didn't you do that sooner? Why did you let the Dothraki ride to their death, which you knew was probably going to be their death, even with their light-up swords, before sending the dragons in as backup? Like, what was the thinking there? Just, oh, guess Daenerys doesn't really care that much about her people after all. So that was dumb. And then all the initial fighting was fun. It was sort of annoying because it was like, oh, you're sending all Evers. First of all, why are like every, aside from Jon and Daenerys are obviously riding around on dragons, why are all of your commanders and leaders in the very, very front? Like, yeah, okay, sometimes you have one leading the charge and that's stuff when we see it, but realistically, if you have like your command, commander should be somewhere where they can give commands. Not like arguably the first one to die because of the first one into the right crisis. Even in well, I don't want to randomly drop Endgame spoilers into here, but you know, even somebody in a movie recently with the battle charge isn't the first freaking person in the charge. So that was just that bothered me. That bothered me a little bit. And then so you see all of these guys and it's like, oh, do they die? Oh, do they? Oh, like teasing them maybe dying, and then almost none of them do die after all. It was frustrating to be like, all right, well, that just, it just seems pointless at this point. So we're watching them get beat back, which we know they're going to do. And so there's some good fighting. A lot of it's really dark and hard to watch, so you don't really appreciate it, especially once they get into Winterfell. Once everybody over, it was a very like a Helm's Deepy kind of moment when they're all climbing up the walls. And once they get into Winterfell itself, I'm kind of like, all right, you can't really tell what's happening. You can't tell who's where. You can't tell if, oh, is Brienne dead? Oh, no, she's not dead. Oh, is Jaime? Nope, they're not dead. Like, they're getting overrun, but then they're fine. Like, what? I will say, okay, Lyanna Mormont with the giant. That was heartbreaking because obviously immediate fan favorite. If you watch the stuff after the show, they revealed she was only supposed to be in one episode. She was only supposed to have that one moment where she's like, we will stand with you, you know, her big brave moment. And she was so great that they wanted to keep her in. And she was so, I mean, this person who was only supposed to have one real moment in this entire episode, in this entire season, or series, they write her an epic death, which was freaking epic. So that was great. Tragic, you know, my soul. But wonderful moment there. And then everything else, again, that's just repetitive. The library scene with Arya was cool, but it dragged on way too long. I did like the moment of her just, you know, up in the classic horror. You knew it was going to happen at some point. She was just going to, oh, there's going to be one, in the way she just dispatched it quietly and immediately and effectively because she's that much of a badass. Again, sort of foreshadows what she's capable of as an assassin. So that was cool, but then it's just, and then so you're, it's over, the same stuff over and over and over and over and over and over. And then, of course, when the Night King raises the dead, which, by the way, why did you stand there staring at him, waiting for him to do what you knew he was going to do, which is raise the dead? Why not just bum rush his ass and fucking start hacking him so we had to deal with you and not raising the dead? Because you're dumb. Jeez, I'm glad you didn't kill the Night King. You're such a freaking idiot. I'm really glad Jon isn't the one that killed the Night King. I love Jon. I think he's great, but he's also an effing moron, and he's not the epic hero in that way. He's the good guy who does the good things, but just like he bent the knee like a bitch immediately, he's not a king per se. He's not that guy. He's the guy who will do the good things, who will do what needs to be done, he will help people, he will do all that stuff. He's not the guy. So anyone who thought he was gonna be, he's just dumb. You just don't know that character, I guess. Why are you sitting there watching Raise the Dead? And then the whole thing, too, is like, all right, Jorah did not have to die because Khaleesi did not have to freaking land Drogon. Why? Why did you land your dragon in the middle of an army of the freaking dead, you idiot? And because of that, now Jorah's got to come and protect her and save her dumbass like he always has to, and then he dies. Now, that is a good death for Jorah, though, because, I mean, that's as he would have wanted, dying, putting his life down for Khaleesi, for Daenerys. So that was an acceptable death for Jorah. Fine. He kind of figured he was gonna hack it. It's sort of just a little dumb. It's like, oh, I guess it makes sense. We spent all this time making sure that you were alive and you were here at this moment with your queen, reunited with your queen, so that you could save her in this pinnacle moment during this battle. So, huzzah. That's it. Like, the deaths don't even have to have that weight and that meaning, because it is, after all, Game of Thrones, where we expect the unexpected, and that's been one of the fun things about the show, which one of my big complaints is that, like, we don't get a lot of unexpected anymore. We don't get a lot of, oh my god, you know? Even with that, it was still sort of this big build, oh, Jorah's about to die, and, you know, it's coming. Like, where are the moments where someone just gets, like, randomly, you know? Like, oh my god, I did not think the character was about to die, and then they do. You know, even Lyanna, you know that giant's gonna fucking kill her, but you know she's gonna kill the giant too, which was just great. But yeah, so it's just like, and then that whole bit, once they raise the army of the dead, it's just, okay, literally the same battle we just had, let's have it over and over and over again, like five more times, before we finally get to the end of the episode where Arya does the thing, the end. So that was like, okay, fucking why? What is the point? What is the actual point? I feel like it was beautiful, exciting, gigantic. It was fun in some ways, but really, realistically, it was repetitive. It was in a lot of ways a letdown. Of course, Ed, sorry, one more death. I would be remiss not to mention a good old Ed, last final Lord Commander of the Night Watch. How appropriate that he should die in the battle that eliminates the need for there to be a Night Watch, essentially. But the rest of it's like, watch this. Stuff. And now this is a funny thing for me. A lot of people after the episode were like, I can't believe it. They just defeated the Night King. What now? Like, Really? Did you? Some people are like, I didn't think they were actually going to kill the Night King in this episode. I'm like, ever since they said they were going to, this Battle of Winterfell was happening, that has to be, do you understand the army we're dealing with? These are the dead. They're not anybody else who gets beaten back, goes back, regroups, and comes back. And once again, the more, you know, the more dead there are, the more powerful they become. Like, they're without killing the Night King, completely unstoppable. So if they win the Battle of Winterfell, it's not like there's some survivors left behind to flank them. No, everybody's gonna get dead, and they're just gonna march through Westeros. So unless this show is gonna go the crazy route of, yep, they lose the Battle of Winterfell, everybody's dead, except for possibly Jon Snow or Daenerys can fly away on their dragons. And then the rest of Westeros has to deal with this shit, making it even less likely that they're ever going to survive because there's just going to be more and more and more overwhelming numbers of dead. No, the second the Battle of Winterfell was happening, you had to know if any of these characters were going to survive, they were going to have to win, and they were going to have to kill the Night King. These are zombies. There's no go back and regroup for them. There's no stopping. They just relentlessly keep going and going and going. So of course that was going to happen. I, for one, am glad they did. I'm glad this entire stupid season, I was actually dreading that they were going to do that initially. I'm so glad this entire stupid season is not a bajillion episodes of build up to this final battle of like, oh, all of our back and forths and our backstabbinesses don't matter because ultimately we're all gonna have to fight the dead together. So I'm glad they just got that freaking over with. It was nice. They've built to this for many, many seasons now, for all of the seasons now. It was, you know, epic, I guess. You could have chopped 30 minutes out of that episode and it would have been much, much better. Everyone's like, oh, the time, I want so much time. Fucking make a better episode, you know? Cut time out. This would have been if they just trimmed all that fat out. This could have been a 45-minute episode, even a 50-minute episode, and it would have been so much better. It could have, because again, it had all those really, really powerful moments. It could have been so much better. Just chop all that out. But anyway, I'm glad this is freaking over with. Night King dead. Now we can get back to the important stuff, which is, of course, the reason we watch this show. And this is another huge thing about why everyone's like, oh my god, it's bad, it's so important, it's so great. This is not how the stories are told on this show. Up until the past two seasons, we have not had moments in battle that define the characters and define the arcs. Previously, beforehand, it was either like, these are the winners or these are the losers. There were never any really contested battles. There was always going to be a clear victor right from the get-go. And the things that change the tides, the things that change the momentum, the things that claim the characters' lives were the unexpected moments. Like, the Lannisters were able to buy back the Freys and have the Red Wedding. Joffrey getting poisoned. All of these moments that suddenly turn the tide, these are not the moments that are defined in battle. It's only been recently. Battle of the Bastard, Battle of Winterfell, and you know, a little bit the Battle of, well, even that one, even when they fight the dead up in frickin', I'm blanking on where that was, something H or something, it was still like, oh, we lost, we gotta bounce. Like, that's the only times where it's like, this battle, oh my god, who's gonna win, who's gonna lose, whether we win or lose makes the difference here, is really, it's that's not how this show is. That's not what the Game of Thrones is about. Game of Thrones is like a big, you know, medieval soap opera in a big way, which is probably why it takes so freaking long for anything to happen. It really is a soap opera. It really is. It's, let me look at you. Let me look back at you. Let me give you significant glances. Let me give you significant, meaningful gestures with my eyeballs. Like, that's what this show is, as much as it freaking frustrates me. But it doesn't make sense for everything to be defined and decided on these huge epic battles. You know, I miss the little finger backstabby, you know, always weaving a web kind of thing. So now that we have that, Now that's over and done with, I'm hoping for, because now you're talking about Cersei's army is much more powerful than the rest of the free people of Westeros. They pretty much have a few ships of Yara's. They've got dragons, which is pretty great, but their army, there were a lot of dead in this thing. So obviously they'll probably be able to get, hopefully, you know, oh, we defeated the dead, you're welcome. Maybe some other people will ally themselves with them as a result of that. But at the end of the day, they're gonna have to do some behind the scenes finagling, you know, to turn the tides against Cersei and her Golden Company and Euron Greyjoy. Euron, it's not his name, but it just makes me think of that every time. So I'm like, Euron P. Greyjoy. Anyway, so I'm looking forward. I'm more looking forward to the. I'm glad that episode is over and done with. It was fine. It was, again, I'm disappointed in the pacing. Once again, I think it could have been a much better episode if they had just tightened it up. I was just like, for most of it. The one thing that really salvaged it for me was Arya sticking it to the Night King. That was good. Overall, though, I mean, really, like, They didn't do anything like Earth Shadow. Oh my God, they killed this character that I thought was gonna live forever, and that sort of disappointed me a little bit. I feel like either Jaime or Tormund could have died. Though I will say, I'm looking forward to more dick measuring between the two of them in reference to them trying to win Brienne moving forward. So that's a nice thing that I hopefully will get. But yeah, there weren't any, like, and that's the thing that Game of Thrones, I think, previously in the books and stuff, had done really, really well, the randomness of war. You know, you don't get to live just because you're the main character. You're not immune just because you're important or special. And I feel like they're still doing that with the show. So that disappointed me for sure. But anyway, other than that, go Arya. She's a badass. If you enjoyed this video, go ahead and press the like button. Click that video, pop it up, so just get involved with me. That'll give you Teespring, Patreon, all of this stuff. I'm getting my Jesse Shop first shirt up and running any minute now, so you can have it. Also, make sure you subscribe to LA Cheesesteak Reviews, my new channel, my newest channel. It's about to be chock full of amazing content you're not going to want to miss. All everything you do, all your interactions, your likes, your comments, your shares, do everything to help me grow, so I really, really appreciate it. Make sure you hit the notification bell so you always know when a new video drops, when I'm going live, stuff like that. You guys are great. That's all. God Empress, out.